A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away. Star Wars, Wild Space, Episode 1, Flight of the Lone Gutker. The Republic has fallen. In its place, the newly risen Galactic Empire tightens its iron grip upon the galaxy. Nearly wiped out by Emperor Palpatine's Order 66, the last surviving Jedi have scattered to the furthest reaches of the Outer Rim, seeking refuge from the encroaching darkness as the evil Lord Darth Vader vengefully scours the galaxy, seeking to eradicate the last traces of the once powerful Jedi Order. Under the looming threat of extermination, a pair of Jedi, hidden on Tatooine, desperately seek passage into wild space, hoping to evade a dogged Imperial Security Bureau agent who remains close on their trail.
Before they overwhelm
you. Looks like they let any scruffy-looking nerfherder in here.
Is that a DH-17 bastard pistol in your pocket, or are you just happy to see me?
I have a bad feeling about this. Are you sure this is safe?
Safety isn't something we are afforded, I'm afraid. I hear tell that a crew of smugglers has docked for this celebration. They may be able to get us to wild space for the right amount of credits.
I sense we found our ride.
They seem lively.
You cheated. You had to cheat. Nobody gets a hand like that every round.
Whoa, whoa, whoa there, fella. Nobody cheated. Just how these pizzak games go sometimes. I really suggest you cozy back down in your seat, for I have my rather large Trandoshan bodyguard. Come put your arms where your legs should be, okay?
No, I'm not letting you cheat us out of our credits!
Now, boys, why'd you have to go and do something silly like that?
Lo, Usant Mata, party now.
Jabba says he doesn't care about it, so we're good.
Can we have just one outing where nobody dies?
No.
You two are Kung, you know that?
But we're your scum. Besides, they were bounties.
Yeah, relax. We're just trying to have some fun first. Even better now that we can turn them over here and get our credits before we head off planet.
Pardon us, are you the crew of the Lone Gutker?
You can tell Black Sun that they'll get their spice when... Yeah, you aren't... Do you need something?
We need safe passage off the planet.
I was just getting to that. We need passage far off Tatooine. We heard you were the best crew to ask.
Oh, I like the flattery. It'll only get you so far, though.
Well, wait. Maybe we can make a quick stop. Where to, mystery man?
Wild space.
Now that sounds like a party.
And like an expensive trip. How many credits you got?
No credits, but we will trade you these.
That's a light!
Shush now, little Thalen.
Those will do. We need to leave. Now.
It's been a few hours since they were spotted. Have you tracked them?
Yes, sir. Landing Bay 7. Squadron of troops is moving there as we speak.
Good. We need to secure those Jedi before he arrives.
After them.
Imperial over us. Get on the ship now and prep for takeoff.
Stop that ship. Blast them.
General, let me help him. My lightsaber will make short work of him.
And we'll give them the full idea that we are Jedi. We cannot risk it, or they'll send the entire Imperial fleet after us, or worse.
bats, nice of you to join us. Please open fire on those bucket heads so we can take off.
Roger, roger.
Everyone's inside. Hit it, Crust.
Yes, miss.
Another close call, but my gut's still in knots. Like something bad is right behind us.
Got away. Track them now.
They will not get far. I sense them moving through the force.
Yes, Inquisitor. I'm so gracious to Lord Vader for sending one of his dogs to chase down the rogue Jedi.
Their lives will soon be forfeit. They will not get away from me this time.
Gate Crashers, a podcast dedicated to kicking open the door to your next favorite thing. Our mission, our creed, our code is this: to make all things nerdy more approachable and accessible to everyone. We want you to find a universe that you will fall in love with. I'm Jake. I use he, him pronouns.
And I'm Dan. I use he, him pronouns as well. This episode is extremely special. We have made it to episode 100. It has been over 2 years worth of podcasting.
It's a lot.
Thank you for being here, Jake. We started this 2 years ago. The first time I recorded, I was sitting hunched over my nightstand in our small apartment. It's a little bit different now.
I was at my college dorm room in a desk in the corner, hoping my roommates weren't loud.
Yep. And now we're here and hoping our dogs aren't loud.
I got the Super Sons first commissioned artwork behind my computer.
Well, which one was first?
The Super Sons one.
Oh, yeah. Well, the logo,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. The podcast art.
It's up on my wall, actually, to my right. It's wild that we've gone from being a DC-centric podcast to what we are now. It's wild how much we've grown. Like, the listenership is unbelievable. Like, I'm shocked how many people listen to this show.
They like us. They really like us.
We've grown out our everything. The website's big. The show is big. The things we do are big. And here's to 100 more episodes. There's a couple people we have to thank. First up is Mike. Without him, the show would not be possible. Simple as that. Every time I have an idea that I text him, he pretty much gets it done. We've done 4 songs, 2 fully original ones and 2 parodies. We've done the Star Wars drama that we've written. You've just heard the first part of. Very excited for you to hear the rest. That brings us to our second person I want to thank is Ethan, who has been with us since probably around the start of Gate Crashers itself, who's taken over the social media and pretty much runs the website.
Yeah, he does it. He does all the things that I can't do because I'm not good at them. Love the guy.
He pretty much edits everything and sets everything up on the website. So shout out to Ethan. Shout out to everyone who works on our website, who's written for us.
All of them. Yeah, all our editors, everybody.
It's been incredible to see the things that are put out on our website, from Kafka to the avant-garde. It's always astounding to me that all of this has come out of Jake and I talking about two terrible DC comics.
Hold on. That's not what it came out of. It came out of me shooting down multiple podcast ideas that you came up with.
And now I was talking to Disney earlier about doing stuff with them. So
that's a wild ride.
Yeah. And it's only going to be bigger from here. But today, Jake, what are we talking about?
We are here to talk about Star Wars, specifically the prequel trilogy.
Now, some people question why we were starting with the prequel trilogy. And the answer is pretty simple. It's our Star Wars. And by that, I mean it's the Star Wars that we first got to say it was our own. I'll talk about my relationship with Star Wars first, just because it's pretty connected to the prequel trilogy. So my dad is a huge Star Wars fan, and I grew up playing with his toys from the original movies. So like the Kerner toys that like nobody could get. It was like the biggest thing. I'll talk more about that in the original trilogy episode, but I've been ingrained with Star Wars since pretty much birth. Like, it's been that series that's always been there, but those were my father's movies. Like, those are the ones he went to see in the theaters and things like that. These ones, though, were the ones that I saw.
Yeah. I actually specifically remember the first time that I watched The Phantom Menace.
Where did you see it? When?
This was in our first house. In the living room one night, you know, because we had the big couch.
Mm-hmm. The red one?
No. The white one.
Okay.
You the one, the it was like L-shaped and it also had like a pull-out bed?
Yes. Yes, I remember that one.
We were both in the living room. We watched it on VHS.
Yeah, I remember the VHS because it had the, is the VHS, didn't it have some of the score? Like, you could watch a video of the orchestra. I know the PlayStation 1 game had that. I don't remember if...
I don't remember.
But I do... I specifically remember episode 2 and 3 because one of my father's friends got us into early screenings of Attack of the Clones.
And we got interviewed? Revenge of the Sith.
That was for Harry Potter.
No. We got interviewed for by some random dude for Revenge of the Sith. Because I remember saying that I really liked when Yoda talked weird.
Where did you get in? Where were we?
We were at the premiere.
Oh, yeah. You did come to the Revenge of the Sith one.
I did. We also went to the Harry Potter one.
Yeah, I remember that one. Yeah, so these movies have been pretty much ingrained in my whole life. Like, I'll never forget seeing episode 2 in theaters because everyone in the theater stood up and clapped. At that one specific scene. But, Jake, for people who don't really know Star Wars, kind of hard not to, why don't you give them the back of the box blurb?
All right. So, today, we're here to talk about Star Wars. Specifically, the prequel trilogies. But what is Star Wars? Well, most famously, it's a series of space opera films, more commonly referred to as the Skywalker Saga. Referring to the family at the heart of these films, full of stunning space battles, imaginative locations, and aliens of all sorts. The prequels, while released as the second trilogy in the saga, follow the story at its beginning, as prequels are wont to do. They set up a lot of the story beats. The audience knew where they could come from in the original trilogy, All the while telling its own highly engaging story.
So, we decided to do the prequel episode as episode 100 because it is Jake and I Star Wars. We're going to have an episode for the original trilogy, the sequel trilogy, and Rogue One. Because all four of these have their own unique entrance points to the Star Wars franchise, universe, books, comics, video games, all of it.
And the real answer is Star Wars Rebels, everybody. Round of applause.
Absolute. Rebels is not the
gateway. No, it's not.
Rebels is a sequel.
It's great, though.
But really, all four of these are different. They're going to be different groups telling you their idea of where the best place to get into Star Wars is. All of them are equal. All of them are valid. Won't hear any of that bullshit about all like different ones sucking, including the prequels and the sequels. Everyone has their own Star Wars that they came into. You got the old people who came in with the original trilogy. You've got the prequels who are our generation. And then you've got the sequels who are the current day. Everyone has their place. And I want to make sure that is said up front because we know there is a lot of toxicity in the Star Wars space. So we're here to kick down those doors and Death Star our way through toxic masculinity. So
I wasn't. Oh, well, this episode's already going to go to weird places, well, as we both know.
Yeah, but I mean, it's mostly the asshole dudes. Never mind. I don't want to get into the negativity about Star Wars.
I agree with you.
So we're not going to talk about the negative things about that surround Star Wars. We're not going to talk about how people recepted these movies because we are sharing our excitement with you. So how did the prequel trilogies come into existence, you may say? Well, when George Lucas was devising what would become known as the original trilogy back in the 1970s, he was overflowing with ideas for this galaxy that he was creating. This led him to plan not only the first three films in his saga, but a trilogy of films that would jump back in time some 20, 30 years prior to the original trilogy to explore how the galaxy we'd seen came to be. He also came up with a plan for a trilogy of films set a decade after the original trilogy, but that's a story for another time.
Let's fast forward to the mid-90s. Having put his plans for a prequel trilogy on hold after finishing the production of the original trilogy in 1983, Lucas, seeing the progress in visual effects over the last 10 years, decided now was the time. And so he set to work, first by writing the scripts, then pre-production, before rolling cameras on what would become known as Star Wars Episode I, The Phantom Menace, in the summer of 1997.
Releasing in 1999, the film, starring a young cast of relative unknowns and Ewan McGregor as the young Obi-Wan Kenobi, and Natalie Portman as Queen Padme Amidala, along with experienced stars such as Liam Neeson as Jedi Master Qui-Gon Jinn, went out to make a lot of money at the box office, like $1 billion, a lot of money.
That is a lot of money. After this, Lucas set full steam into production of the latter two films in this prequel trilogy, which would go on to be known as Episode 2, Attack of the Clones, and Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith, respectively. With the films essentially being shot back-to-back, Lucas and the whole team he'd assembled for these films worked their asses off to get them made. Joining the cast was Hayden Christensen as Anakin Skywalker, who would, spoilers, go on to be known as Darth Vader in the original trilogy. That's a pretty important role. That's a pretty big thing, guys. Releasing in 2002 and 2005, respectively, these two films also went on to make a boatload of money at the box office.
Now, what we haven't touched on is the reception of the film. Obviously, as previously mentioned earlier, they made a lot of money, money-wise. The critical and public reception was a bit mixed. I don't really want to get into that too much just because this isn't about that. This is about how these movies make you feel.
Yeah, so the legacy of the prequels lives on, was built upon, some would say redeemed, by the release of the animated TV series The Clone Wars, which is actually the second Clone Wars series in 2008. Set between episodes 2 and 3, the show is fills in a lot of the story gaps and character motivations that may have felt missing in these films. The show was so successful that after it was canceled in 2013, fan support eventually brought it back to conclude its storyline in 2020 with a finale that intertwined with the events of Revenge of the Sith.
Yeah, those. I just rewatched, I rewatched the entire trilogy in like 2 days. So I watched Attack of the Clones and then I watched Revenge of the Sith Monday night and it's like 2 a.m. And I was like, I'm just going to finish it. And I went and watched The Siege of Mandalore from The Clone Wars. So who may like this? Honestly, Star Wars is for everyone. There's something that's going to capture everyone's imagination and just make them excited to be watching something. The movies are meant for kids. They're kids' movies. Saying that,
yeah,
that's what they're for. And that's why a lot of this reception is so negative, because adults cannot get over their mindsets of things. It is the biggest sci-fi franchise of all time. It's huge. Star Wars is everywhere. And the films are the best place to get in. But we will have a ton of content on our website this month for you to find different places to get in. We'll be highlighting comics, video games, movies, and people's experience with the franchise itself. Where can people get these three, though, Jake?
Well, Disney Plus, digital retailers. I almost said realtors. I've done that before, Dan. I've done that before. and any places DVDs and Blu-rays are sold. I got my copies at, I think, Costco. I got the nice steel books.
I don't think I have. I think I have it. The Blu-ray, they put it a couple years ago. I don't know if they have 4Ks yet. But honestly, I own them all in one form or another, but I just watch them digitally because I don't have to change them. Honestly, the one I watch the most is Rogue One, and you'll find that out later in this month. Or honestly, if you know me, you know I watch Rogue One the most.
The one you tweet about the most.
It's my favorite. Yeah. So, what we watched Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, Star Wars Episode 2, Attack of the Clones, Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. We also will probably get a bit into the last season of Clone Wars, if not more. So be aware of spoilers for that. We're going to break here. After the jump into hyperspace. Man, I should have stayed with that synergy. We will be talking
synergy,
all about...
everyone, synergy!
The Prequel Trilogy. So bring it back in with a... it's just 2 hours of us making lightsaber noises.
Oh man, I should have grabbed my lightsaber.
Just us making Star Wars noises for 4 episodes.
Yeah. This can be in an outtake. This can be an outtake.
Annie. No. Yippee! All of this is. I'm gonna do this entire episode in a Jar Jar Binks voice.
Well, we'll take it from the top.
I can't do a Jar Jar Binks voice. All right, so where do we want to start, and why is it Anakin Skywalker?
Well, I'm just gonna say it. Yippee!
I guess we should talk about the evolution of Anakin, like where he starts in The Phantom Menace.
That's what my notes are talking about,
and where he goes from there.
Yeah, so let's talk about Jake Lloyd and just as a character in Episode 1, he's really just the stand-in for the younger audience members.
He's got this absolute innocence to him because watching it now and watching it like not critically, I'm not a critic, but like watching him talk about things, how he wants to get off the planet and see the universe, and he wants to save his mom and do all these things, and like how confident he is in himself and his pod racing ability, but you see that sometimes he isn't. He gives a really good performance for a kid.
He does. And I think the character can be very fun when the writing is working in the character's favor.
Yeah. I had the poster where he has the shadow of Darth Vader on the wall, and it was so cool as a kid, like seeing like this little kid who's like me. We had the same haircut. I had a bowl cut like this kid.
We all had the bowl cut, Dan.
Is going to grow up to be Darth Vader.
Yeah. One thing I noticed that I don't think it dawned on me until watching it for the episode is that his starfighter is always yellow. Like, I knew they were yellow, but I never thought about it in the idea of that's what the starfighter he flew in Episode 1 was also yellow.
Wait, what else is his starfighter? Jedi starfighter
is gold leader.
Oh, yeah. Huh.
Yeah. Didn't dawn on me.
Huh, now it's dawned on me. I didn't even think of that.
Yeah.
Huh. But I don't know if that has any significance. It might. I just don't know what yellow represents.
I don't know. I just think it's yellow.
It's an interesting thing to see this kid grow. Like, seeing episode one and then realizing he's becoming a Darth Vader, and you don't know what steps. As a child, you didn't know what steps would get him to become this evil, this ultimate evil.
The answer is love.
Yeah. And it...
The path to hell is paved with good intentions.
Yeah, it's... And watching it now, I don't think his performance is all that bad.
No.
Because he...
His acting isn't bad. He was just given some clunker lines.
Yeah.
Like, yippee.
I think episode two, you see this. You see this innocent kid, then you see this arrogant...
angsty teenager.
This arrogant, angsty teenager. But then in the third movie, you see that he's disillusioned with the whole idea through the poisoning of his mind from Emperor Palpatine, from the shit the Jedi give him because the Jedi are evil. And it's just like, see the downfall.
He's clearly a veteran in episode three. Like
he's been through it.
Like he's confident. He's not arrogant anymore, but he's confident.
And he should have had a spot on the council. And I'll argue that, like, we'll talk about the Jedi more in later in this episode.
Well, I think it's important to note that he's like the public figure of the war. He's the face of it, of the Clone Wars.
Yeah.
He's the general that everyone knows about.
Yeah, he's the poster child. Like, and he's been so many places. He knows so many people. All of the troops know him.
Public opinion never turned against Anakin. Never.
I mean, other than... before he murdered everyone.
Well, they didn't know about that.
Yeah, I mean, the Jedi turned on pretty quickly when he started chopping them up, including the children and the women, too. But even then, like, in episode two, he slaughters a full village. He kills them all. And Padme's still like, yeah, all right.
Yeah, I'll date you.
Not even that. She let him clap her cheeks. Like, they had a baby, two babies. And, like, you see this angry young man who has been dealt this shit hand.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I'm not making excuses for Darth Vader. I'm not. But you see the evolution of what made him a monster. He was and is a monster until the very end.
The answer is sand.
Yeah, it's coarse and it gets everywhere. But, like, you see, like, I think Anakin is such an interesting character. I mean, even with the Clone Wars, like, you get so much more of the stuff he's been through, and he, like, cares. He loses everyone he cares about. Like, Ahsoka. He loses Ahsoka.
He does.
Because of the Jedi. And, all right, we're gonna go right into the Jedi right now, because I need to talk about it, because it's just making me angry.
How all the whole downfall of the Republic is kind of Mace Windu's fault?
And don't just put that on Mace Windu.
It's also
on Yoda.
Also
Yoda
on Yoda.
Sucks.
Yeah.
So let me get this. Let me just get this all out.
But I put more blame on Mace because he is the master of the council. He's in charge of the council, whereas Yoda is in charge of the order itself.
Yeah, and he's also he's arrogant in a way that is it's not like watching the Siege of Mandalore. When he talks to Ahsoka, he's like, this isn't for citizens. Like, she's helping you. Why would you be such a dick? So, all right, let me talk with the Jedi. So, in episode one, we see that the Jedi Order is big. They've been around, what do they say, 1,000 years?
Yeah, something like that.
So, this order has been around pretty much, I don't know, probably since before the High Republic. So, they've been around forever.
Yeah,
but now they're on Coruscant. The Republic is growing, and there is a war being created. The war is absolutely 100% all Palpatine. Both, all the sides are Palpatine.
Yeah.
He's playing chess on three different boards by himself. But the thing is, the Jedi feed so well into that. The entire idea of the Jedi is to not use their weapons for, like, force. They're not using their abilities to hurt people, but they are. The entire prequel trilogy, the Jedi are soldiers. They're just an army. They're just a mass army that's going and slaughtering.
Yeah, it's very interesting because there are times where the Jedi Knights have been more like knights, and in this they're supposed to be more like monks, and they're crusaders.
Yeah. As a kid, I was like, oh, the Jedi are so cool. They're doing good stuff. Now that I look at it, like, yeah, sure, the Trade Federation was doing all those taxes and things like the bad stuff they were doing, but they weren't using people. They were using droids. Now, be it that that could be a money thing, like it could be cheaper to have droids, but they're not using their own people. Like, they're the different, there's like the Outer Rim who's fighting to be free of the Republic's reign. Like, they're trying to stay away from what eventually becomes the Empire. They're trying to stay independent and live their own lives, and they're not letting them. And they're enforcing their iron will because, again, it's Palpatine behind all of it. But the Jedi should be smarter than one Sith Lord, right? Like, there are how many? There's that librarian who says if it's not in the library, it doesn't exist. Like, these people are so sure of themselves because they've had no enemies for how long? Like, there's not, like, a huge Sith... You can't. There's the rule of two. But, like, there's not a huge...
Well, we know that's not true.
Yeah, but there's no, like, dark... They haven't been challenged in so long. They've become so bloated and, like, the only thing out there that they become this army. And they are the reason they are destroyed. The Jedi are at the root of their own destruction. Mm-hmm. And Anakin brings that about because the Force wasn't balanced.
Yeah,
he it wasn't bring balanced at all. Force. Yeah, he brings balance to the Force. I mean,
if you think about it in what comes out in the original trilogy, there's only Obi-Wan and Yoda. Two for two.
And then there's Darth Vader and the Emperor.
Yeah, it's two for two.
We'll just go with that instead of saying all the different random Jedi who lived and are mulling around the galaxy. And
yeah.
Because at that point, it's not even the Force that's... The Force is pretty balanced. It's just that evil one. Like, it's not the Force users who are the full evil. It's the things they've done. And, like, the Empire and all that stuff. But that's built on the Republic. So it's all very complicated. And I think... I don't want to go into the other movies at all. But the only one that's ever made a point of it, of, like, making this known, is... I literally just blanked on the name of episode 8. How? It's the one everybody argues about.
The Last Jedi.
That's the only one that's ever made a point of being like, neither side is good. You realize that, right? Like, they're paying for these same ships that the other side is. Like, you're all evil.
Yeah.
It's just you're seeing your own views. And it sucks because all these innocent people are caught in the crossfire. I mean, it's politics. It's how the world works. But it's so interesting to see that as I thought of it as a kid, now how I think of it now. Because, like, Yoda was cool as shit. Like, Yoda is cool as shit. But Yoda also shit the bed. Like, Yoda's old enough, he should have known. Like, he's been through some stuff. He should have, like, he could have stopped. They all could have stopped it if they weren't so blinded by their own power and arrogance.
Yogurt? Yogurt.
Spaceball's the flamethrower. The kids love this one.
But Yoda decided to lead the clones into the war.
Yeah. Let's go back.
He started that war.
Yeah. Do you have anything else to talk about Anakin before we move on to his master?
Honestly, Anakin's one of my favorite characters. That's it.
Yeah. I think Anakin's awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, until he becomes, you know, mass murderer Darth Vader.
But then he looks cool.
Yeah, he looks cool as shit. Darth Vader is such a cool look. So let's talk about Obi-Wan. So when we first meet Obi-Wan, he is still a Padawan. Mm-hmm. Like, he's still under Qui-Gon Jinn, who's also a badass. When we first meet him, that's one of my favorite battles of all time, because that's the first time you see lightsabers used as, like, weapons and not, like, ceremonial weapons. Like, it's very fast and, like, they're like...
Talk about fast, you mean for speed?
Yeah. Yes, they use it in episode one, right?
Yeah.
And it's never talked about again.
Yeah, like, these are actual combative uses of the Force.
Yeah. And when he puts the lightsaber through the door, that was the coolest shit ever. Like, watching the lightsaber, like, pierce it and, like, go around.
This is my lockpick.
Yeah, it's awesome. And it's just, we see Obi-Wan, and he's a kid. Like, he's still a kid. I don't think about that because...
He's young, he's eager, but he's also respectful. But he also will question if he believes someone's in the right or not. Like, he has beliefs. He's not like, but he's willing to discuss them. You see the backbone of what he eventually becomes in the original trilogy.
Yeah. I think I like Obi-Wan more than I like Anakin, just because Obi-Wan has this dedication. I know you have notes, I'll let you get some in a second, but Obi-Wan has this dedication to the Jedi Order and the way things are done, but I think he also understands that it isn't 100%. Like, he knows it's not the best way to do things, but he's contemplative enough where he has bent his own rules, because 100%, I don't care what anyone else says. I don't care if you come at me in the comments or at me or show up at my house. Obi-Wan and the Queen of Mandalore, that's their kid.
Yeah.
That's their kid.
Yeah.
As a Jedi, you can fuck, you just can't stay.
Yeah.
And you can't love. But Obi-Wan loved her. He loved, like, you see it. Like, in the Clone Wars, you know that he cared about her, because we'll talk about I don't want to get to the relationship yet, but, like, you see that Obi-Wan has these connections, and Obi-Wan
cares. It's wild that Anakin Skywalker is actually just Martin Luther.
Like the 99 thesis, Martin Luther?
Yeah.
How?
I don't know, because one of the arguments for the schisms and stuff like that was priests marrying.
Yeah, but Martin Luther nailed things to a door. He didn't chop up a bunch of kids.
I mean, it did lead to a lot of war.
Yeah, all right. But, so,
I stumped you on that one. You're back to Obi-Wan.
We see Obi-Wan grow in these movies a ton, but in a different way than Anakin. Like, he had to grow up too fast.
Yeah, like, in episode two, you really do see that he's taking himself a little too seriously. Like, he's got to do it for Anakin's sake. Like, he's...
So...
Yeah.
I think we could just... So, in episode two, Anakin says he's like a father to me. And I've been thinking about this a lot since I watched them. He says he's like a father to me, to Padme. But in three, it's more of a brother relationship, and we see that through the Clone Wars and things like that. I think there is a tonal shift, because Anakin sees Obi-Wan as a father figure from one to two, and then two is when he gets assigned to the Emperor. And from there, the Emperor pollutes his mind, and then he becomes the father figure to Anakin, because Anakin grew up without a dad. He doesn't have a dad. He was Immaculate Conception.
Yep.
His mom and Shmi.
He's Space Jesus.
Shmi just had him. So he is probably looking for a figure, because he never had, like, his mom was on Tatooine. Like, he left. He never had a role model. So Obi-Wan was his role model. But as he grew up with Obi-Wan, while the Emperor was already playing this game of chess and easily took him under his wing to become his father. And it's sick. Like, I want to talk about Palpatine a lot, but I think the relationship with Obi-Wan is one of the best things about Star Wars, and it's heartbreaking.
Yeah, I
want you to talk about your Obi-Wan stuff before we get to their relationship.
So, yeah, no, in episode two, he's kind of, like, authoritative for Anakin. but like he's kind of like a middle school teacher who has to be a little stricter to get the kids to listen. And then in episode 3, he's loosened up a lot. He's making jokes. He's constantly making mm-hmm. jokes. Like
when he leans against the ship, when he's like, "Oh no, Anakin, you did all that. You carried me on your back as you saved everyone."
Yeah, like he uses the fact that Anakin used to love to brag about saving him against mm-hmm. him. And you could see that the way Anakin reacts to it is also different. Like, oh man, no, don't use this against me. And also, his beard in 3 looks a lot better than it did in 2.
His beard and hair. He looks great in 3.
I mean, his hair looked good in 2, but his beard was like not, it was all the same length and not like shaped.
Yeah, it's a very weird look. I really think very he looks round. Best in 3.
Yes.
The whole thing, like, oh man. Let's talk about their relationship, because I think probably the scene that will always make me cry in Star Wars is the last one. When he slices off Anakin's legs and like Anakin's and his arm, and he's laying in the fire and screaming that he hates him. Obi-Wan has given his entire life to Anakin. Like, he grew up so fast. Just being
brothers. Dan, I hate you.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to kill you and leave you by a fire lake too. But please, it's not even just that. It's just like the fact that Anakin is saying these things, and Obi-Wan is like, you were supposed to be the one that saved us. Like, I loved you. You were my brother. But the fact that he says, I loved you. Jedi are not supposed to love, but Obi-Wan loved Anakin. Anakin was his best friend, yeah, his attached. Brother, his child, like he grew up for Anakin. Everything he has done is to protect and help Anakin. And the order that he served betrayed him. Like, they failed Anakin.
They did.
Obi-Wan feels that he failed Anakin. Yeah. Everyone feels that they failed. Like, Yoda probably doesn't, because Yoda sucks. But Obi-Wan feels that he failed his...
People are going to hate that line the most.
Yeah, good. Yoda and Mace Windu destroyed the galaxy. The Emperor was smarter and played them like fiddles. And they fed right into it.
Yeah, it didn't help that Mace Windu was like, no, the Sith don't exist anymore. They're dead.
Yeah, he was so arrogant about it. He also didn't say motherfucker in the movie at all.
Like, well, it's on his lightsaber, it's fine.
Yeah, when he looks at Count Dooku.
I'll be honest, I love Samuel Jackson.
Oh, I love Samuel Jackson. I will see, I'm probably going to see his Hitman's Bodyguard's wife or whatever. Does Samuel Jackson
love like anime and hentai too?
He's so funny. He's just a funny dude. He's like,
he's great.
Love Samuel Jackson. Hate Mace Windu. But Mace Windu's cool as shit too. Like, he's a really good fight. Like, he is the, he's a special type of Jedi, isn't he? He uses the Force in a combat specialty.
He is able to use aspects of the dark side. Yeah. That's, I don't know what the actual concept of his purple lightsaber is now. I know the original term was he had a vision of it, so he just like, I need to go on a quest to get this purple crystal for my purple lightsaber.
I mean, that makes sense. Like, the idea of...
But also, that's greed.
Yeah. Jedi don't feel that either. But, the Anakin-Obi relationship just hurts. Like, So, Scarlett and I, years ago, when she graduated, we went to Disney World, and I went to the Star Wars dessert party, where it was an open bar. And I made friends with the bartender, tried every Star Wars drink they had, at a couple too many, and I was asking the Jawas if they knew my uncle, Jabba. But afterwards, there was the fireworks, and the fireworks were Star Wars themed. So at one point, they showed that scene, and I'm probably the only person in this crowd crying. Like, it's like, no, don't show me that. You were supposed to save the Jedi Anakin. You're supposed to bring balance to the Force. That scene is probably my favorite scene out of the prequel trilogy. That and the battle for Geonosis. Like, I love that scene.
Oh, yeah.
That scene slaps. And everyone gives Attack of the Clones crap, but like that scene is so cool.
I mean, dude, hats off. I mean, Django did hats off. Got him.
We'll talk about the villains in a second and what I wrote as Django's name. Yeah, Battle of Junos. Let's talk about the fight scenes a little bit before we talk about Padme.
Oh, how so, they slap?
Yeah, let's. What is your favorite fight scene from the prequel trilogy?
Oh God.
Yeah, hard hitting questions.
Yeah,
hard hitting journalism.
I mean, ooh, that's a good question. there's something about the way that the lightsabers flash in the face of Anakin and Count Dooku in Episode 2. That is so cool. It just stuck with me since childhood. Like, I'm pretty good about separating my nostalgia from things, but like that's a scene I'm nostalgic for. Also, it reminds me of the Star Wars cereal.
Oh my God. With the spoons?
Yeah, spoons.
Shit, you think I could buy a box of that?
It's
probably not it's, good, right?
It's fried cornmeal. Who knows?
Star Wars cereal. I could get it's Baby Yoda cereal. $2 from Walmart. Done. I'm gonna
wait. From Walmart.
Yeah, it's Baby Yoda.
Oh baby yeah, there Yoda. Is Baby Yoda baby cereal. Yoda. I saw that the other day.
A little Grogu snack. I'm surprised it's not got soup.
Bone broth in it.
There's a lot of soup in Star Wars. I don't know if that's a lot of different soups.
I think that's just because it's one of the easier things to make a lot of. Yeah. Because I just want to throw this term out. The gentrification of the Star Wars universe after the Emperor takes over, because this is something I thought a lot about. Like, there's a lot of culture in these films. Like, you get to see a lot of the Naboo. What would be the
Nabooian?
Nabooian, that's what it is.
Nabooian?
I think that's actually used in there.
Is it?
When they're in Gunga.
Dude, Gunga. Well, I'm going to save that because I want to talk about...
But Gunga, culture, dude, culture! And then it's just...
All right. So, fight scenes, humans. What are they?
I already answered.
That's you don't have any other favorites?
Well, yeah, the Anakin versus Obi-Wan fight.
Yeah, that's amazing. I mean, that's the best one.
Know, they have such great end fights.
Yeah. Okay, so my favorite is the Darth Maul, Qui-Gon Jinn, Obi-Wan. I love that battle where they're jumping from the different platforms. Or when the Emperor and Yoda fight, and the Emperor is just like, you get a politician standing. You get a politician standing. He's just throwing
and
these
then
things
Yoda's
we've
like,
seen.
I'm going to add a little spin to this
one. Yeah. He throws a little spin trick on it and hits him back. The
he says, let it rip.
Okay, so the Emperor. The Emperor fight in 3 where he jumps over the table screeching. That was awesome.
Killed my boy.
What does he say? So it's treason. So it's treason then. He flies over the desk. His lightsaber is badass. Do you know why his lightsaber is badass?
Because it's full of electrum.
Yeah, and that's what the Jedi Temple guards use, right?
And the Council.
Yeah, that's just spitting on them. It's like, toot, toot, toot.
Yeah, you only get that when you join you get the option to add it to your lightsaber when you join the Council because it's lightsaber proof.
God. And the Emperor just has his decked out in it. I think they made...
There's two of them. He has two of them.
Yeah, which one did they make?
He does it as an insult.
God, what a guy. What a guy. And like that's a character I've always wanted to see use a lightsaber because all we've seen him do is his jazz hands with the lightning.
Jazz hands.
Oh God, I love I don't want to say I love the Emperor, but I love the Emperor. I think he's such an interesting character, especially let's talk about the Emperor. It's time. The Emperor, I'm going to make a case that the Emperor is actually the main character of all 3 trilogies.
Well, I mean, The Rise of Skywalker basically said, yeah, that's the case.
Yeah, this is actually the Palpatine saga. You can't tell me I'm wrong.
Hold on. Did Rey say she was Rey Palpatine, even though that is the case?
No, she said, you're right, it's the Skywalker saga. But like,
but also then there's people saying that Palpatine used the Force, manipulated the midichlorians to make Anakin, even though
that wasn't a comic.
Yeah, no, but I liked it better when it was Darth Plagueis.
Yeah. Plagueis just out here getting people pregnant. But like,
this is all I want to do.
So the Emperor like carefully does everything. Every single move is calculated, and he does it perfectly. Like, he takes over the galaxy. And Jar Jar Binks hands it to him. Like,
it's Jar Jar.
Everything was orchestrated by the fact that I just bought the Star Wars cereal spoon on eBay.
Well, you also have the bottle opener that I bought you.
I did. No, I really just did that. I did just buy the red lightsaber spoon from the Kellogg cereal.
The Kellogg's cereal.
Am I going to use it?
The Kellogg's. Yes, you are.
Oh, wait, Jake, do you want a box of the cereal? Because they also sell it on eBay. It's only $17.
No.
Would you eat it with me?
Yeah, I'll eat it with you.
And then we won't have episode 200 because we'll be dead.
I think this cornmeal's gone bad, guys.
Do you think I would get sick?
I don't know.
I mean, it's only $17.
I mean, it's probably loaded with sugar, so it's probably kept up really well. It's probably just stale as hell.
It's got Anakin and Count Dooku. All right, never mind. Let's get back to the episode before I end up buying a bunch of weird Star Wars crap off of eBay. They also make a Mandalorian snack time game. All right, back in. We're back in the trenches. Padme.
Macaroons without the filling.
Let's talk about Padme.
Sorry, macarons.
Macaroons.
Macaroons.
The Mandalorian macaroons.
I can make those.
The outfits. Let's talk about Padme's outfits because they had to cost so much money.
What's your favorite? I kind of like the funeral outfit, the shimmy funeral outfit.
So the funeral that she, like when she dies, that she wears?
No. The one that she wears to Anakin's mother's funeral.
Oh.
You know, the one with the midriff?
Yes. No, because the one that she wore to the funeral, I took a picture with it.
And you wore it, and you got chased out of Disney?
Yeah, they chased me out of the museum. It's...
You still have it.
I don't know. I'm trying to think of my favorite Padme dress. And it's, honestly, it's cliche, but it's probably the red one. Like, the red one that she doesn't even wear. The one with the face paint and stuff.
Yeah, she only wears it, like...
Oh, it's okay. Not her.
Yeah, no, it's because it's always a different outfit when it's the queen.
Yeah.
And then there's also the, you know, the adventure outfit, which is really good.
Yeah, her wedding dress was really cool, too. She's got a lot of great dresses. It's such a good... The costume design in these were so good. Like, Anakin's costume is, like, incredible.
Mm-hmm. I kind of wish they hadn't gone so dark in Attack of the Clones. Granted, I know it gets darker in Revenge of the Sith. But, like...
I hear Mom.
It's her birthday. Even though it's fine.
Yeah. What was I going to say? Yeah, it's... Yeah, it's got to be the red one. I don't think I have... I really want to know the price of all of them. Because I know a lot of them were like actual...
Hey, George. How much does this cost?
Text him at like 3 a.m.
How did you get this number?
Jan, I thought I blocked you. All of her costumes are great. Like, they had to cost so much money. But I did want to... I know we talked about it for a second, but the old switcheroo, that blew my mind as a kid. When they were on Naboo and they were talking to Boss Nass, and you find out that she isn't the queen. Like, the one who's been with us the whole time. What did she call herself?
I don't remember what her name was.
Yeah, I can't remember either.
All I know is that Padme disguised herself as a handmaiden.
Yeah, and I think it's so cool because I did not see that coming.
Also, I'm still dumbfounded when I remember that they are elected officials for the queen.
Yeah, because she's not the queen in episode two, right?
No, she's a senator because her term was up.
It's so odd. That's such an odd thing that it's like an elected queen.
Yeah.
I always forget that Palpatine is from Naboo as well.
Yeah. He was the senator.
Which makes
sense.
Never
trust a senator.
Naboo is like a... it's rich. They're like rich. God, it's just wild that he took over the galaxy so easily.
I mean, he was manipulating a teenager and a very not-so-savvy alien.
800-year-old dude. I don't know. Padme and Anakin's relationship is weird, kind of. Mm-hmm. But
it doesn't really ring true until...
Midway through two, the Clone Wars, and then episode three.
Yeah.
Because in episode three, it's really well done. Like, she, like... It feels more real. And I guess it comes with them growing up.
I also think it has to do with the fact that Hayden Christensen kind of stopped listening to George.
Yeah, sometimes you can't listen to George.
Yeah, no, because you listen to Hayden Christensen talk. He's like, yeah, I didn't really know what George was talking about most of the time.
Yeah, I mean, does anyone?
But also, did you ever watch those, like behind the scenes stuff where Hayden Christensen's kind of just asking people questions?
No, I will. I've only seen
his conversation with George is great because that's where I learned that fact from.
I've only seen the George when he was like, what was it?
The Mace Windu conversation?
No, where he said, I may have gone too far in a couple of
places. Yeah.
That is one of my favorite George moments. That or the one... Have you seen the thing where he shows up in the background of a documentary? Where he's just walking down the street?
Yes.
He just walks in and he's like, oh, that's George Lucas. Or the fact that he wears the same fit to every premiere these days, where he wears just like
the white and blue
dad jeans. Yeah, and he wears like New Balances. What a guy.
He's a king. He's a king.
If it wasn't for his wife, we wouldn't have Star Wars.
True.
Where do we want to go next? You want to talk about our favorite Jedi?
Yeah.
You can go first.
I love Kit Fisto. Like, he's just so cool looking. And his lightsaber works underwater. He can fight underwater. And then he's like, you know what? It's time for the water, baby. Time to get undressed. Let's go. Sun's out, guns out. And, you know, rip to my boy. It's hard to know that smile is gone forever. We also know that he was banging a... What's her name? I always forget her name.
Sakura?
Yeah.
No. Was he the Twi'lek?
Yeah. They were banging.
Good for them.
But, you know, they weren't attached. They were not dating. They were banging. But they were not attached. They were good Jedi. You know, they were good Jedi.
Jesus. R.I.P. Kit Fisto gets hit like with one slash from...
Well, he blocks one.
Yeah, but then he gets like not even like sliced in half. He just gets like...
The man does a spin like a Beyblade and lunges at you and screeches.
You're caught off guard.
Yeah.
My favorite is Plo Koon, and he has been since Jedi Power Battles on the PlayStation 1. And in Jedi Power Battles, he has an orange lightsaber. So Jedi Power Battles was made after episode 1. So in episode 2, they show Plo with a blue lightsaber.
Doesn't Mace Windu have a blue lightsaber?
Maybe?
Pretty sure he does.
Which is cooler to have an orange lightsaber. But they also... Wasn't Plo Koon the one they were going to have... with the saber gauntlets?
Yes.
Where it would be like kind of like a Wolverine type deal?
Yes.
Which would have been sick. Yeah, he does, Jake. He does have a blue lightsaber. But Plo has He's got a yellow or orange, whatever you want to say. Would have been sick if they let him keep it, but then he got a blue one. Totally fine. But I think his appeal to me only went up. Like, I've always loved him because he looked just weird. I'm a big fan of, like, lizard people and things like that in all fiction.
But he's
in all fiction.
What if I told you, I mean, if he had those claws, he'd be more crab-like.
No. But he is one of the characters in the Clone Wars that, like, is the first people to be like, no, you matter to the clones. And I think that's super impactful because in the films, the clones are kind of just treated as disposable. While they're not, they're people. They have feelings. And we get to explore that a lot in Clone Wars. That's what I'm writing for this month of Star Wars stuff. So, spoilers. But Plo, like, takes this kind of mentorship with Ahsoka as well. Like, he's the one who found her, isn't he?
Yep.
I don't know. I'm looking at him right now. He's on my desk. He's my favorite. And then come to find out Dave Filoni also loves him. So when I watch Clone Wars, you get all the Plo, like you get it all. And he's got Plo's bros. He's got his, the 104th battalion, which are the wolf pack, which is his people because Filoni is obsessed with wolves. So like I got a lot of my boy. So that's really important
Dave
to me.
Dave Filoni has one of those shirts. That you get at like the zoo.
The wolf shirts?
Yeah.
I have a couple of those shirts.
I know you do because you specifically wanted them as Christmas gifts.
Yeah, I did. Go, Dan. What a guy. Dan McMahon. I got a lot of feelings about Star Wars. I love it. But you know what a lot of people have feelings about, Jake?
Midichlorians.
What are your feelings?
Well, in regards to the Force, you have to have the word "the" in there because if you take it out, it gets. You could say use the Force. You can't just say use Force, guys. It gets real bad. That's all I got. That's all I have.
So I don't care.
But midichlorians, it doesn't bother me.
Yeah, it's like a living organism that's in people. It's kind of weird, but like, it doesn't really change too much.
No.
I like the idea that anyone can be force sensitive, including droids, because like, C-3PO and R2-D2 have to be force sensitive because like, those fuckers get out of everything. Those husbands, they get out of every situation ever. Like, C-3PO becomes a battle droid in episode 2.
Yeah.
And we get to see their relationship bloom in these. I don't have any notes about C-3PO, but I'm going to talk about...
I mean, R2-D2 is probably one of the most fun things to watch in all of these movies.
Oh, they're incredible together.
He just kills super battle droids.
Yeah.
He lights them on fire.
Yeah, C-3PO talks, R2-D2 doesn't, but their chemistry is unbelievable. They're incredible. Like, them talking back and forth and C-3PO being like, no! Like,
and
that
yet
kind of
the
stuff.
Actors hate each other.
Do they really?
Yes. Huh. Then again, most people hate, what's his name?
That's wild. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
But
R2-D2 and Chewbacca, I don't know why I'm blanking on their names because I'm not good with names of people.
Peter Mayhew?
Yeah.
Hold on. Kenny Baker.
Yeah, They had a beautiful relationship. They loved each other.
Yeah.
They were really good friends.
Yeah. I love, man, Peter hit me. It was so good.
Yeah. It's sad they're both, you know, passed.
Yeah. So we talked about Papa Palpatine, talked about the Midichlorians. What we didn't talk about yet is the other villains.
You mean Robo Leg Man?
Who is your favorite villains out of the prequel villains that aren't Papa Palpatine?
Ooh. See, every time when you ask me this question, my brain goes right to the Clone Wars. When these guys get, these characters get actually fleshed out.
Who you got? I can give you mine.
Yeah.
General Grievous. Love General Grievous. That spider bitch. He's incredible. This fucker kills Jedi and takes this weapon that is so, like, important to their religion, like, their life. And it's just like, motherfucker, I got, like, 30 on me at all times. He opens his cape and he's just got, like, all these lightsabers. And it's like a reminder that he's not Force-sensitive. This is just a hunter. He is an apex predator whose body is gone. They took his body parts and threw him in another bad bitch. He is fucking awesome. He's got organs in a, like, a tomb.
Well, no, but wasn't that originally supposed to be because Mace Windu crushed his
crushed his lungs. Yeah, his little spider mode, and his arms split into four, and he's got four lightsabers, and they spin. He's awesome. He's got the cool cape. Looks like a vampire. I love General Grievous.
Well, on the term of vampire, I guess I'm going to say Count Dooku.
Yeah, Count Dooku is badass, too. Yeah. And I think a lot of that comes from Clone Wars.
Yeah, I think in, you know, the actual films, it comes across as more like, he's doing this for, like, a political reason. He doesn't. Mm-hmm. He's not evil so much as he wants to be out from under the Republic.
Yeah.
But then you go and watch Clone Wars, it's like, no, he's a Sith. He's a real Sith.
Doesn't he try to get Obi-Wan to go against Palpatine with him?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he was in it for himself. Like,
oh, yeah.
But,
like, the films, it's more like he's more for his people. And
yeah, but he's not.
No.
Remember his little pajamas?
Yes.
Can't you put this on in the Battlefront games?
I don't know. I can't play the Battlefront games because for whatever reason, I could play Battlefield, but I can't play Battlefront so because it's like, oh no, EA's saying that you're too young. What?
So let's talk about the other villain of episode 2 before we get to Darth Maul, because I know everyone's waiting. Let's talk about Jango Fett Kennedy. And I make that comparison because both of them lose their head. Is it a coincidence? I think not.
Well, both of them. Someone's going to get angry about that one.
Yeah, whatever. JFK bought an election with mafia money. So Jango Fett, I don't think Jango Fett's a bad guy. I think Jango Fett was out there making a paycheck.
No, he
was
not a bad guy.
He was a bounty hunter.
He's a bounty hunter. He's all about that money. So is Bobo.
So the thing about Jango is that the clones are Jango Fett. Like, all of them are cloned from him. But his payment, all he wanted was just a perfect clone of himself. Like, he just wanted a son. That's Boba Fett, you know, from the Star Wars movies.
Jango Fett, Mandalorian.
He's not Mandalorian, is he?
Did you not watch The Mandalorian? It's canon. He was raised he was a foundling.
Oh,
from Death
Watch.
Yeah,
he was a foundling.
Which was the original story before Clone Wars aired.
Yeah. God. Probably should have done a Mando episode. That show's so good. Did you finish season 2?
Yeah.
God, that ending. And, like, I get it's fan service, but, like, fan service I love. Let's get to him. Let's talk about Darth Maul.
Crab legs. Spider legs. Darth Maul, the legs. But not his own.
Darth Maul gets, like, such a... They made him out to be, like, the big bad guy of the new Star Wars movies. And he quote-unquote, dies in the first one. He does get to come back in Clone Wars
as
and get
Maul.
Has his awesome arcs. And he comes back and he's in everything. Darth Maul is awesome. So, like, him getting more screen time off screen of the films is awesome. He's got the double-bladed lightsaber.
Which I'm still surprised that when you look at it turn on, the actual hilt gets bigger.
Yeah. I deleted that note, I guess. I wrote a note earlier where I was talking about the battle droids, because I love robots, just like in general. Let me see if I can find it. Why won't mine?
Yeah, you deleted most of the notes.
I didn't mean to do it. Let me find it. Because I wrote a really good note about the battle droids. I wrote that the battle droids... I'm so embarrassed.
Well, while you talk about... When you look for that, I'll talk about buzz droids. Buzz droids. They're basically the Flood from Halo. You know, but they have buzz saws and they get into an actual fight with R2-D2 on the plane. Well, there's on also Starfighter. It's not a plane. It's a Starfighter. Anakin's trying to scoop him off with his wing. And it kind of just, you know, makes things a little more hard, difficult for Obi-Wan Kenobi, who's his only hope.
Thrawn actually gets buzz droids.
Yeah.
I don't know if were they in Rebels?
Were buzz droids in Rebels?
No, he gets them in the book at least, and he uses the heat. Thrawn is awesome. Thrawn is a whole other thing. I really wish
they had gone into the whole him meeting Anakin.
That book isn't that great, I'll be honest with you.
No. I just wish they'd gotten into it in a comic.
Yeah, where it's the show.
Because I think the comic is a little more concise.
No, the first book is awesome. The second book is too much.
I'm not talking about quality. I'm talking about conciseness.
Oh, here's my note. I fucking love droids, my guy. Destroyer droids, rip. Battle droids, slap. Super battle droids, fuck. That's it. That's all I wanted to talk about. Vulture droids. Those are the big ones, aren't they?
Yeah, they're the planes.
Yeah, I don't really care about them. They don't talk or have any. They're just kind of.
They can
battle droids. I know they can do the little walkie thing. But I think the battle droids are probably one of the coolest things. Yeah, they're hilarious. When General Grievous does all of his lightsabers in Episode 3, and there's two in the background, and the one slaps his buddy's shoulder and points to General Grievous, that's the stuff I do love. They're so funny. You want to talk about the? I want to save. I'm going to highlight it. I want to save this for last. The clone army is kind of complicated in these movies. Like they don't,
they're just kind of, I mean, the only one you really get to see is Cody.
Yeah. And you know what happens to him?
He sucks.
Like eventually in the show, you'll watch the Clone Wars. It's incredible. And you get so much more background and nuance. And you see that these clones aren't just disposable to the Jedi, especially to Anakin and Obi-Wan.
Yeah, I mean, Obi-Wan goes and wears their armor and fights in battles until the Jedi tell him, you got to stop doing that.
Yeah, because Obi-Wan is loyal to a fault.
Yeah.
I love. All right, let's talk about the score, because we'll be talking about the score in all of them. I'm not even going to ask. The best tracks from these three movies are. You've got Episode 1, you've got the Duel of Fates, which is one of the best pieces of all time.
Yes.
Simple, no arguments. Yes. I don't care about your opinion on this. If you don't think the Duel of Fates slaps, you better get ready to duel for your fate, because I'm coming for you. Because
if you don't think it slaps, he's going to slap you.
I'm coming for you. Then you've got Episode 2, which has... Across the Stars, which is the Anakin Padme love theme, which also slaps. That shit I'll get played at my wedding. Like that's one of the best. Then you've got Anakin versus Obi-Wan in Episode 3. All three of honestly, John brought his A game. Like John always brings his A game, but like the sequel music is good, but it's a lot of like the themes you already know. Ray's theme is awesome, but. Those three are like the tracks that will always stick out of my head. The Duel of Fates, like I have like back squatted to the Duel of Fates. Like I've done hardcore workouts listening to the Duel of Fates. That shit gets you pumped.
Yeah.
Swinging around dumbbells like they're lightsabers is awesome. Dang, it's really painful, everyone. Excuse me, sir. Can you please leave? But yeah, these movies have so much political stuff in them. Which is a huge turn from like the original trilogy, which is a lot of people don't like them, but I kind of like that shit.
Yeah, no, it makes sense. Like you're dealing with like the bipartisanship of you know the Senate, and that's like a big concept in the whole movie.
Dude, I would love to see like a mini series about like Star Wars politics. Like, imagine a political thriller set in the Star Wars universe. You mean the
Padme episodes of Clone Wars?
Yeah, yeah. But that brings us to our final thing about the prequels. And I'm going to put an idea forward that a lot of people might not like.
Skip over love?
We talked about that with Padme and...
Oh, you're right.
With Padme and Anakin. But this is a hot take, and a lot of people are going to disagree with me. And a lot of people are jaded and...
Cynical?
Just cynical and hate fun. Jar Jar Binks is awesome.
He's kind of great.
I love Jar Jar Binks. He's funny. When Qui-Gon Jinn grabs his tongue, he's just a fun guy. Like,
he's fun.
He's not in episode one as like a warrior.
When you say tongue, I want to talk about the merchandise.
Yeah, you can talk about that in a second. But like, Jar Jar Binks is there by happenstance. Like, they stumble upon him. He gives all the power to the Emperor eventually, but like, he's so funny. And like, this movie's for kids again. He's got such like a big heart, and he just does his best, and he's just kind of an idiot, which is fine. Like, Gunga is so cool. The concept of Gunga is so cool with the orbs underwater. Badass. But honestly, I love Jar Jar. Like, I was watching this and like, I was laughing. I was like, oh, all right. Maybe I didn't like Jar Jar because everyone told me I shouldn't like Jar Jar. Jar Jar Binks isn't that bad. He's comedic relief in a movie where you're watching
it'd be very thick without him.
Yeah. Yes. He's really slapstick. That's all it really is. Yeah.
I don't have anything else. I think you said that perfectly. Like, Jar Jar is actually kind of great. Like, I think I'm more like when I go through rewatches of Clone Wars, which I think I've done twice now, I'm more likely to skip a political Padme episode than I am a Jar Jar Binks political episode.
Misa good at politics.
Yeah.
He makes me laugh.
So, do you have anything else to say? Because I got a good sign-off.
Well, I just... Yeah, the merchandising. I remember...
Oh, yeah. That's what I brought that up. Whoops. Yeah. So, there's the Jar Jar Binks lollipop where the lollipop is encased in his head, but it's... The lollipop is his tongue. You just got a French kiss him.
But I remember, like, grandmom taking me to Pizza Hut so I could get the Star Wars pizza, like, the cup topper... Like, things like that. Like, yeah. I remember probably the first time I ever had Taco Bell, which, you know, is a lifelong staple of mine, is to get the shadow boxes that they have. They have the shadow boxes where, like, one side would be Anakin and the other side would be Darth Vader. Like, this movie was so heavily merchandised. Star Wars is merchandising. And it's funny,
Someone
I'm sitting here.
That's why they did it.
Well, George
did it.
That's why George made his money. Because he didn't get proceeds from anything but merchandising. He kept all the merchandising rights, which is why George made so much money, because this thing blew up and nobody believed in him. I've got all this plastic on my desk.
Watch the toys that made us, everybody. Yeah. Ugh. Was it from the films that made us? No, it was from the toys that made us.
Toys that made us. I got Hunter from Bad Batch, a Mandalorian from... The Siege of Mandalore. I've got a battle droid who is sitting like really sad, like sitting on the edge. Clone Trooper, Plo Koon, Ahsoka. And then I've got Darth Vader in the background because he's watching. I'm just going to try to set up my desk with all the toys that I've got for these episodes to keep my energy high. How did you want to walk this episode to an ending?
Now this is podcasting.
Wow.
Yeah, no, I made that joke one. I made that comment one day after watching it. I said to Ethan on game chat, I'm like, you know, the description has to have now this is podcasting.
It does. I'm looking at the tweet right now.
Yeah, Ethan was like, Jake, don't worry, I gotcha. It's in there.
But that's all we got for this episode. Episode 100. Thank you for listening.
Yeah, baby.
This has been a constant joy in my life to be able to do something with consistency. We've never missed a week. Just being able to do this and have people listen has been a joy and a blessing. So thank you for supporting us. I'm hoping soon we have t-shirts. Maybe I'll make them before this episode airs so I can put the t-shirts up on Wednesday that this releases, which is next Wednesday. But at the end of the day, seriously, thank you for supporting us. It means the world to us. Letting us into your ears and to help you find new things that you're going to love. You can find us at gatecrashers.fan. You can find us on Twitter at gatecrashers_pod and on Instagram at gatecrashers_pod and on Facebook at gatecrashers. Thank you. May the force be with you.
Bye.
Gatecrashers.